Brain Teasers, in association with Ophthalmological Society of Nagpur, presents the Big Q. That's a pan-India intercollegiate quiz for the second time in our country.
End of the day, ऊपर तेरे lucky है performance की तलवार, ऐसी दरिया है ये, remember कर ले, जो डूबे वो ही होता है पार, जो भी आए यहाँ पे उसको chance एक मिलती है, हर नजर की यहाँ पे सोचो एक मंजिल ही है, मौका मिले तो खोना नहीं, ये आएगा ना ये बार बार.
Everyone. So welcome.
Good evening. And
yes, Sai, keep playing the video. Sai.
Enters who have logged into today's episode. Brain Teaser is an online quizzing platform which was introduced 3 years back by Team Sarakshi Netralaya, with an aim to have an edutainment program for ophthalmologists across the country. Since then, it has been associated with various state, national, and international societies for conducting their quizzes, to name a few: Delhi Ophthalmological Society, Bombay Ophthalmological Association, Ocular Trauma Society of India, and almost all state societies. Last year, we had the privilege to host, for the first time in our country, an All India Postgraduate Quiz in association with Bombay Ophthalmological Association. This All India Postgraduate Quiz, named Big Q, had a participation of more than 150 teams from colleges across the country. Buoyed by the success of Big Q, this year the Brain Teaser, in association with Ophthalmological Society of Nagpur, that is OSN, decided to host once more an All India Postgraduate Quiz. We are extremely thankful and humbled by your overwhelming response, because as on date, more than 400 teams have already registered for the same. In fact, this year, we also had added few new dimensions to the Big Q by having quiz masters from across the country, who themselves are not only the ace quiz masters of their region, but also prominent ophthalmologists. The Brain Teaser has a big following in general ophthalmologists, who also wanted to rub their shoulders with the young postgraduates. So, we also have created special categories of prizes for all the comprehensive ophthalmologists, which will be given in every episode. Every registered postgraduate not only becomes eligible for participation certificate, which would add weightage to their CV, but also brushes his knowledge. For 6 winning teams, there are huge money prizes, which Dr. Shilpi will elaborate shortly. We welcome all the mentors who will be guiding force for every team. As a token of appreciation for their efforts, every mentor gets a surprise gift prize from Team Big Q. Besides the cash prize of ₹15,000 for every mentor of 6 winning teams in the final. Today, we have the privilege of having 3 quiz masters from across the country. Dr. Vishal Agrawal, an eminent vitreoretinal surgeon and a dear friend of mine from Jaipur. Dr. Rolika Bansal, an upcoming oculoplastic surgeon from Hyderabad. And Dr. Sugath Uppal, an eminent phaco and glaucoma surgeon from Kolkata. Welcome all. We are thankful to Mr. Sai Krishnan and his Numerotech for giving an efficient backup office for smooth conduct of this online event. Money maketh a mayor go. Nothing is possible without the financial aid from trade partners. We are thankful to Microlabs for the generous support And few names definitely needs mention. Mr. Ashok, Executive Vice President, and Mr. Navneet, who are really working hard to reach out to every student in any corner of our country. Here is a promo from MicroLab. Request my co-host, Dr. Shilpi Narnavare, my VR colleague, to familiarize all the participants with the rules of the game. Over to you, Dr. Shilpi. Thank you.
Thank you, Prashant, sir. Good evening and Happy New Year to all of you. Welcome to the first episode of Season 2 of Big Q. So now I will familiarize all of you with the format of the quiz and the rules. So now let's look at the format. So this season will be conducted on every Wednesday at 8 p.m. The platform for playing the quiz is Kahoot. So there will be total of the 15 episodes in this season, which will consist of 8 preliminary rounds, 4 quarterfinals, 2 semifinals, and 1 final. Each team will comprise of 2 postgraduates and 1 mentor who is faculty from the same institute. Mentor will not be playing with the PGs as he or she is only a guiding force and will log in from a separate Zoom platform. All the teams can play 8 preliminary rounds. The total of the best 4 performance in the preliminary round would be considered for qualifying the quarterfinals. What happens if any team misses few preliminary rounds? As I already told, minimum of the 4 preliminary round is mandatory to be in contention of the quarterfinals. In all, 80 teams will qualify for the quarterfinals. So 20 teams will play per quarterfinal. Of these, 20 teams will make into the semifinals. And of these, 10 teams will make it to the finals to be played on. Let me remind you once more. This time, the platform of the quiz is Kahoot. So every team needs to log in from the 2 devices. First screen is a live quizzing screen, which will happen on the Zoom platform. It is must to keep your Zoom video on with the audio off for us to able to monitor the teams. The second screen, that is the Kahoot, will be used to record your answer. Mentors will log in from the separate screen only on the Zoom platform. So in this episode, there are total 9 rounds, which will consist of 5 questions in each set. Of the 6 sets of MCQs, you will be given 15 seconds per question to record your answer. And for the 3 sets of one-liners, 30 seconds per question will be given to you. Assessment will be done on the fastest finger first. But remember, you have to be really fast and as well as well accurate. Of course, the judge's decision is always final. There is a huge prize money besides the glory and the certificates at stake for you. The prize money in the finals for the team 6 will be 5,000. For team 5, it will be 10,000. Then in the ascending order, it will be 15,000, 20,000, 30,000. And the winners will carry away the 50,000 cash prize. And also for the mentors of the 6 winning teams, they will get 15,000 rupees cash each. And of course, for the audience, We have prizes in every episode. The second runner-up will get rupees 2000, first runner-up will get rupees 3000, and the winner will get rupees 5000. Now, I request the quiz masters to carry forward the proceedings of today's episode. The opening quiz master is Dr. Vishal Agrawal, who is eminent ophthalmologist from the Jaipur. Over to you, sir.
Dr. Vishal, to share his screen and carry forward.
Yeah, you have to stop sharing so that I can share my screen.
Yeah.
Can you see my screen?
Yes, Vishal.
Okay. Good evening, all the participants, all the postgraduates, the mentors, and the quiz masters with me here. And I'm ready to rub shoulders with the young blood, as Dr. Prashant said. And we'll start the quiz right away.
Vishal, today we are very lucky. We are having 537 teams to play today.
Yeah, I'm lucky.
For the highest numbers for any quiz across the country.
Doctor.
Yeah.
Doctor, just can we give around 2-3 minutes, please?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, we can wait. Any problem? Ashok sir, any problem?
They are not able to log in. That's why they want because some people are finding it difficult to log in. Just 2-3 minutes only, please.
Okay, we can start at 8:30 exactly.
Okay. In the meantime, you can run some other old videos or something, sir. Or you can speak to somebody.
Yeah, what we can do? Yeah.
This is the first time because we have to give them some time, sir. Please.
We do understand this is a record performance of any online quiz having more than 537. How much is it? 553 teams which have registered, latest count. So I think quiz masters, you have a big task ahead of you. Rather, I have completed my formalities. Vishal, Dr. Sugathoda, Dr. Rolika, a lot of expectations is at our hand. Important.
Doctor, sorry to interrupt.
Yes,
there are a lot of queries asking for the game pin.
Okay.
So please announce the game pin. The game pin is 7140063. I repeat, 7140063.
Can you type it in the chat box, Sai?
Yeah, I've already done. But anyway, for people who have asked, it is Kahoot pin is 7140063.
7140063. The participants do note it. So you have another 3 minutes to log in. Otherwise, we would have to continue with the quiz. And importantly, participants, remember, it is the best of the four performances. So you have to, all of you, try preferably to play 8 all quizzes, all the preliminary rounds. But best 4 performances of you will be considered. So even if you miss out, if some of your colleague misses out on today's quiz for want of knowledge, you can tell him to join later and then they can be part of other team. Okay? So don't worry about it. We will be having them, and even if they can compensate for the first round, because it is going to be the total of best 4 performances. And for the mentors, we are really thankful. The Big Q team is, of course, very thankful to you. We are for encouraging your teams in such a big number. We will be acknowledging the presence of all the mentors who are going to be live with us today. The first 10 performers will be invited on the Zoom platform at the conclusion of the quiz, which is done. Also, remember the audience who are participating. You will be called the best 3 performers. They have a prize money. They will be invited on a Zoom platform at the conclusion of the quiz. So be ready. Just don't log out the moment the quiz is over. Just wait. Keep in and let's see who will make it into the finals. So Dr. Rolika, Dr. Sugato, Dr. Vishal Agrawal. Can you hear me?
Sir.
Yes.
Yes.
We have, this is 537 teams. What do you say? How is the response? 553.
That's huge. That's huge, definitely one of the largest ever.
We are really excited about it. So I think it is the Quiz Masters and the team of BigQ which is attracting so many people. And of course, the Microvision team, which is making every effort to reach out to every postgraduate in our country at various corners. And really proud of you, Aradha. I should pat the Microvision team for reaching out people and getting the teams enrolled in such a big number. And probably to some extent, I can give credit to our own last effort when we had about 140 or 150 teams. That was our first effort with Bombay Ophthalmic Association. And this is fourfold response this time. So I would like to pat myself as well as Shilpi a bit, as well as Sai for publicizing the quiz well. And of course, to the previous participants who also have spread the word about the BigQ, the prize money, and the interest which it generates and the knowledge sharing which happens with this platform of ours. So I think we should be proud of it. So, and we have to live up to it. So I think, Sai, should we start? It is almost ready. Ashok, sir, if you permit me.
Yeah, okay, sir. Okay.
Yeah. So Vishal, over to you.
Sure, sir. So we'll start with the first MCQ. Listen carefully. You have 15 seconds to answer that. Okay, regarding optical coherence tomography angiography, OCTA, which statement is most likely to be true? It requires an intravenous contrast agent. It delivers lower resolution than FFA, fundus fluorescein angiography. It is more prone to artifacts than fundus fluorescein angiography. Or the D option is, it is more time consuming to perform than FA, fundus fluorescein angiography. Your time starts now. You have 15 seconds. Now you have to stop the timer. It's not moving on my screen.
I'll let you know once the time is up, Doctor.
Yeah. You can see the options on your screen. You can see the question on your screen. Which statement is most likely to be true for OCTA?
Time up.
So the answer is C. It is more prone to artifacts than fundus fluorescein angiography. So the advantage of OCTA is that it does not use dye. But the disadvantage in the current machines is that it has a lot of motion and projection artifacts because of the slow speed and the 3D dimension of the vessel projection on the screen. So a lot of artifacts are there in OCTA as compared to fundus fluorescein angiography. We'll move to the second question. You can see the white arrow on the screen of the OCT image. Now you have to tell what is the layer marked with an arrow on this optical coherence tomography image, the white arrow. See carefully. Is it the outer plexiform layer? Is it the inner nuclear layer? Is it the ganglion cell layer? Or is it the inner plexiform layer? Your time starts now.
Why is the timer not ticking?
I will tell when the time is up. Sai, the time is up.
Time is up.
So the answer is inner plexiform layer. So the correct order of the layers of the retina are from inner to outer is ILM, nerve fiber layer, ganglion cell layer, inner plexiform layer, inner nuclear layer, outer plexiform and outer nuclear layer, external limiting membrane, and RPE. A helpful mnemonic to remember is, in new generation, it isn't only ophthalmologist examining every retina. You can find it in many books. So the layer which was marked by the arrow was inner plexiform layer. We'll move to the third MCQ. Listen carefully. Which of the following histopathological stains is most useful in the diagnosis of Evelino corneal dystrophy. Alcian blue. B option is Congo red. C is hematoxylin and eosin. And D is oil red post stain. Your time starts now. Stain used for diagnosis of Evelinov corneal dystrophy. Alcian blue, Congo red, hematoxylin, eosin, or oil red. Now the timer is working. Time up. The answer is option B, Congo red stain. It's a combination of granular and lattice dystrophy. And the stroma contains a lot of amyloid, which is stained best by Congo red. Am I going too fast or it's okay? Can you understand my questions and options very well?
Yeah, I think so. It is adequate. You have to be a bit louder.
Okay, I'll be a little louder. The fourth MCQ is, you can see the fundus diagram and the gray part is the retinal detachment with fluid. And this is a fundus diagram of the right eye. And the question is, where is the most likely position of the tear in this detachment diagram? The shaded area represents the area of detached retina. So where is the most likely position of the tear according to this diagram and configuration of RD? Inferonasal, inferotemporal, supronasal, suprotemporal. Your time starts now. You have to look at the diagram and tell me, click the option where the most likely position with the tear is according to the configuration of the detachment. Time's up. So the answer is supronasal. As you can see, the development of subretinal fluid within RRD follows certain patterns, and retinal breaks can be located by looking at the distribution of the level of the subretinal fluid. And these principles follow gravitational forces, first documented by Linkoff and also known as Linkoff's rule. The last MCQ of this first part is, which of the following statements regarding intravitreal lampalizumab injection for dry ARMD is correct? Hear the word again, intravitreal lampalizumab. Lampalizumab inhibits complement factor H. Lampalizumab does not reduce the enlargement of geographical atrophy. The benefit of lampalizumab is influenced by the complement factor profile biomarker. Lampalizumab is associated with higher risk of post-operative endophthalmitis, post-intravitreal endophthalmitis. The timer starts now. Intravitreal lampalizumab. Let's see your knowledge and insight about this drug. Time's up. The answer is option B. Lampalizumab does not reduce the enlargement of geographical atrophy. I'll tell you something, a little short brief of lampalizumab. It's a selective component factor D inhibitor. Unfortunately, the phase 3 trials, PROMA and SPECTRI, were shut down because the drug did not reach the primary endpoint. It did not reduce the area of geographical atrophy. So, but the pathway is inhibition of complement factor D, not H. So the B option, that it does not reduce the enlargement of geographical atrophy size, is the correct answer in this case. So I think my 5 questions are over. The first part,
hand it over to.
I am handing now the quiz to the second quiz master of the evening, Dr. Saugata Paul. Sir, you can share your screen.
Yeah.
He's a senior consultant eye surgeon at Amulya Jyoti Eye Foundation in Kolkata. He's the joint secretary of OSWB, Ophthalmological Society of West Bengal, and is the managing committee member from ISOC. Over to you, Saugata.
Yes. Just give me a few seconds.
Sure, sir.
So is my screen visible and I'm audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes. So good evening to all the participants and thanks for the huge response. So I'll start my questions now. They're quite easy. So you have to be very fast and quick to give the appropriate answer. Here comes my first question. So Fincham test is used to differentiate between color halos of dry eye and immature cataract, immature cataract and the glaucoma, dry eye and glaucoma, and full thickness macular hole and lamellar hole. Your time starts now. So time is up. It's a very easy question. And the answer is the immature cataract and glaucoma. So Fincham test, what we do, we use a stenopic slit and we move it across the pupil. What happens in glaucoma? The halos remain stable, but immature cataract, it gets broken. So that's how we differentiate whether it's from the immature cataract or is from the acute glaucoma. So I'll start my second question now. So the word uvea literally means what? Again, a very easy question. So I'm sure all of you will be able to answer whether it is cherry, whether it's the strawberry, not with the cream, just strawberry, or whether it's grapes. And the last option is apple. So your time starts now. Good. So the answer is, I'm sure everyone has got it. The answer is the grapes. Now the participant should leave all your video on so that we can monitor you. So please leave your video on. Don't switch off your video. So I'm coming to the next question. In phacomorphic glaucoma, it is an open angle glaucoma. It is a close angle glaucoma. It can be both of the above, combination of open angle and close angle, or none of the above. Your time starts now. Again, these are all first year questions, first year PGTs. So the answer is, I'm sure, again, everyone got it. It is close angle glaucoma. The lens is swollen in phacomorphic glaucoma, which reduces the space in the anterior chamber, which leads to the close angle or leads to the raised intraocular pressure. So next question, again, I'm sure you should be able to get it. World Sight Day is observed every year, the second Thursday of October. B, alternate year for the second Thursday of October. Option C is alternate year of the fourth Thursday of October and 7th October every year. Your time starts now. So I'm sure again, everyone got it. I have left the question quite easy to encourage the people who have joined the first quiz, they get good marks and they can carry it forward. Again, the answer is every year, second Thursday of October. It's the second Thursday of October every year we celebrate World Sight Day. And the last question of this series, which of the following structure is not derived from the surface ectoderm? Options are corneal epithelium, crystalline lens, the sclera, and the epithelium of the lacrimal glands, which is not derived from the surface ectoderm. And your time starts now. So the correct answer is the sclera. All the other derived from the surface ectoderm. The sclera is it develops from the mesenchyme of the optic curve. So the answer is C. So with that, I end here. And let me introduce my next quiz master, who is none other than Rolika Bansal, who is the budding ophthalmologist from Hyderabad and oculoplastic surgeon. She has owned all the forums she has won awards, like the most prestigious, like Cornell Rangachari Award in AIOS, AIOC, and also she stood first in her MS ophthalmology. She has a lot of travel glands, lot of book chapters she has written. So, and she is a very good quiz master. Hope she will give you a great time. So over to you, Dr. Rolika.
Thank you so much, Sagata sir.
I can stop sharing my screen.
Yeah, you have to stop sharing.
Gee, sir.
So I can, yeah.
Yeah.
Is it still sharing or stop?
Yes, sir. Yeah, my screen is visible?
Yeah. Very good, Rolika.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Sagata sir and Prashant sir and Shilpi ma'am. And welcome everyone to the first episode of the Big Q. And I will be starting the third section of the questions. I won't delay. So let's move on to the next question. So the question is, optic nerve sheath meningioma. It is associated with which one of the following symptoms or signs? Diplopia, inophthalmos, progressive visual loss. Just a second. Yeah. So the answer to this question is progressive visual loss. So as you all would know that optic nerve sheath meningioma is really not associated with enophthalmos, it's actually associated with proptosis on the other hand. Diplopia is basically considered as like an indication of no optic nerve sheath meningioma, as even if there is ocular motility restriction, it's very mild. And we also have to look for von Recklinghausen disease in these patients. We have to look for the features of neurofibromatosis too, as it is often associated with the same. And of course, on MRI, you will see a very clear cut, on radiology, you will see a very clear cut tram track appearance. So you should not miss on these. So moving on to the next question. Is my screen visible?
Yes, it is visible.
There is apparently some error over here. Just give me a second.
Okay. We can, in fact, see your question as well. Thigus and keratitis.
Right, sir. Just one second. I'll go ahead now. So thigus and keratitis associated with which one of the following? It is normal corneal sensation or subepithelial infiltrates or conjunctival hyperemia or peripheral corneal lesions. So your time starts now. So the correct answer is normal corneal sensation. So Thankinson keratitis is mostly bilateral. It is asymmetrical keratitis. And in this, we see a small oval, grayish white opacities. And these opacities are basically intraepithelial and not subepithelial. And conjunctival hyperemia is very less seen to be associated with it. And these lesions are mostly central. So all the three are ruled out, and normal corneal sensation is the correct answer. So moving on to the next question, which one of the following is associated with siderosis? Now, this happens to be a very easy question for all of you, and I'm sure of it. The options are scleral melt, hyphema, heterochromia, or granulomatous uveitis. So let's get this answer right. So I'm sure that most of you got it right, and that is heterochromia. So siderosis occurs due to a ferrous intraocular foreign body where it dissociates and deposits on the intraocular structures. And over here, the iron deposits go and they deposit on the iris and leading to heterochromia iritis. So moving on to the next question, cystoid macular edema or CME. Peaks after how many weeks of the cataract surgery? And let me give you a hint, it's a syndrome. So it is 1 to 2 weeks, 2 to 4 weeks, 6 to 10 weeks, or 10 to 14 weeks. Your time starts now. So the answer is 6 to 10 weeks. So this is basically Ehlers-Danlos syndrome that is associated with cystoid macular edema. It is very less commonly seen after uncomplicated cataract surgeries. Actually, it is mostly after complicated cataract surgery, and the onset is 6 to 10 weeks. It's best to go ahead and do an OCT in these cases. Moving on to the next question. And that is which of the following is most likely to be associated with neovascular glaucoma? The options are iridocorneal endothelial syndrome, ocular ischemic syndrome, uveitis glaucoma hyphema or UGH syndrome, or vitelliform maculopathy. Your time starts now. I think this was an easy one, but the answer is ocular ischemic syndrome. So the ischemia part releases angiogenic factors, which leads to new neovascularization or new vessel formation, which occurs even at the angle, leading to posterior synecae formation and therefore glaucoma. So these were my questions, and over to you. I'll stop my sharing. Over to you, Prashant, sir.
Vishal, over to you. So now right. We will be starting with one-liners where you have to type the answer. So Vishal will introduce it, and it will have 30 seconds for you to record your response.
So is the screen visible, sir?
Yeah, I can see it.
I'll start the one-liners. The response time is 30 seconds for the one-liners. And there are 15 one-liners, 5 per quiz master. So this is just a spotter, not even a one-liner. You can see this iris ring, and you just have to name the implant. Very simple. Sorry, I cannot see the timer. You have to count for me and stop at 30 seconds.
I'll do that.
Okay. Just see the implant very carefully. And it is a segment, and you just have to name the implant, what it is known by. what name by it is known by. Okay, time's up. So the name is Mocher's implant, and Mocher is basically it's a pioneer in iris segments, capsular tension rings, IOLs, and it's a German company. And this particular implant is an NIRIDIA segment. It's used in the surgery for NIRIDIA patients. And the model number is 67F.
Can I stop you for a minute, doctor?
One minute. Sure.
See, I have answers like iris implant, NIRIDIA implant.
See, it is an implant. The only answer, correct answer, will be the exact name, the proper noun, not the where it is used. So, if anybody has it with the name of Mocher, the spelling might be wrong, but the pronunciation should be same. Then it is the correct answer.
Got it.
Okay. So you have to see the visual field. It's a 24-2 threshold central field, and you have to name the scotoma presented in the field. It's a very simple one. You should all get it right. Your 30 seconds have started. See the field properly. See the defect. See the type of defect, the area of defect, the location of the defect, and a very straightforward answer. Name the scotoma. What is this scotoma called? Time's up.
Just a minute, doctor. Not yet. Hold on.
Okay, no problem.
Time up.
Okay. So the answer is centrosecal scotoma, and it's a very common scotoma in toxic optic neuropathy. The treatment, of course, is the withdrawal of the toxic agent and supplementation with hydroxycobalamin or vitamin B12 oral, as well as a balanced diet of protein. The third one-liner, see the photograph properly, clearly. The first is the iris photograph. The second is the lead photograph. It's a very straightforward question. Diagnose the condition which is causing these abnormalities in the iris and the lid. Your timer starts now.
It is the same link as for postgraduate.
Now the timer is visible on my screen. See the iris photograph, see the lid photograph. I've given a lot of clue which abnormality or the condition causes both these. Your time's up. The answer is neurofibromatosis. And just a brief about that, you can see the left side of the photo was iris, and there were lish nodules on that. And the lid had a S-shaped deformity of the upper lid. And it is a phacomatosis, neurofibromatosis, with autosomal dominant transmission. One liner number four, diagnose the condition. See the eye movements towards the left, towards the right, and diagnose the condition. Your timer starts now. You have 30 seconds to diagnose this abnormality. A hint is that you can see the right photograph and then you can diagnose the condition. See the eye movements. Again, it's a very common diagnosis. It should not be very difficult for you.
Hold on.
I've already displayed the answer side. So the answer is Joanne's retraction syndrome type 1. And the pathophysiology is basically the absence of lateral rectus innervation by sixth nerve and abnormal innervation of lateral rectus by fibers of the third nerve. And this is, there are three types. This is a type 1 DRS. Sai, you were telling something?
Just hold on. Just hold on, doctor. I mean, there are quite a few answers which I'll have to validate. Just hold on for a few seconds.
No problem.
Yes, Sai, we have to proceed.
I can validate the answers after the one-liners because my part will be over. Then I'll be free for 5 minutes. Okay.
I think the marking will happen.
Okay, we can proceed, doctor.
Yeah, okay. Thank you.
One-liner number 5. See the picture carefully. See the picture carefully and the lens type put in the trial frame. At what distance is this test done? So the question is not what test is being done. Of course, that is, that's part of the answer. But at what distance this particular test is done? Your timer starts now. See the lens put in the right eye. So you have to tell me at what distance this test is done. It's a very simple, you know, lens. It's a very commonly used lens in the squint clinic if you have attended it. Time's up. So the distance is 5 to 6 meters. So it's a Maddox rod test and it is done at a distance of 5 to 6 meters. Most commonly used to diagnose chorias and it's made up of, 6 to 7 cut cylinders. So that is my share of one-liners. I'll pass over to the next quiz master, Dr. Sugathada, for his set of one-liners.
Thank you. So I'll start my screen sharing. So again, an easy round. Just. So, first question comes here. So, name the organization who has taken up the VIIP project, vision impairment and intracranial pressure. Your time starts now. So you can look from the picture itself, it can give a clue. And the answer is NASA. So NASA has started this project to basically check about the intraocular pressure in the space. So coming to the next question, again, identify the instrument shown in the photograph. So your time starts now. It's a historical instrument. If you look at the left hand side, that can give a clue. Sai, there might be a lot of answers to validate in this question.
Okay.
So the answer is...
Hold on, doctor. Hold on, please.
What happened, Sai?
No, timer is not yet done. Ah, it's done now.
No, timer was done. It played on my screen. The 30
seconds.
Yeah, it played
only 30 seconds.
Yeah.
Go ahead, sir.
Shall I wait?
No, go ahead, sir.
Go ahead, show the answer. Oh.
Okay, is the Castrovejo cataract erysipelas palm system. So basically, it was used to be extracting the cataract before the phaco came, or before even we started using the intracapsular forceps, this system was in vogue. So Sai, I'm sure there will be a lot of answers. So shall I move on to the next question?
Just a moment, doctor. I'm just finding out if minor spelling changes, I have quite a good number of answers.
I think we can accept a minor, means, you know, it's a proper noun. Minor, we can have some thing. More important is erysipelas palm system. Okay.
Yes.
Okay, Dr.
When you are ready, Sai, I'll move on to the next question.
You can go ahead, doctor.
Okay, again, a very easy question. Ciliaretinal artery is a branch of which artery? The time starts now. I think we should give only 10 seconds for this, or 5 seconds for the PGs. We are monitoring on the video. And the answer is very, very easy question, posterior ciliary artery. Now it's a self-explanatory answer. I'm coming to the next question. So again, a very easy question.
Hold on for a moment.
Anything other than posterior ciliary artery is wrong answer.
Any confusion, Sai?
Too many answers with minor spelling changes, doctor.
See, for postgraduate student, this spelling, minor spelling change for this one shouldn't be accepted.
Correct. I think so. Because this is a very simple one. For a proper noun, it is different. But if here, their spelling mistake is wrong.
Anything other than this shouldn't be accepted. Okay.
Fine, Sai.
Got it, doctor. You can go ahead.
Okay, so what is the slit lamp beam setting in the sun grading system? It's not the sun pharma, it's the sun grading system. And you should write the height first times the weight, width. So height, then width. And your time starts now. So again, it's a very easy question, and the answer is 1 millimeter by 1 millimeter, and this is basically used to look at the uveitis patients, and the height and width are same, 1 millimeter by 1 millimeter. So coming to my next question, that is the last question, again, identify the structure visualized in this photograph. Your time starts now. And one clue is it is not the oral denture. I'm sure everyone will get this. So the answer is the ciliary body. Again, Sai, no minor spelling changes is accepted in this.
Yeah, it's a proper noun. Everyone should know here. Basically, it's a simple structure. Sai, should we proceed?
So I'll hand over from this to Rolika.
Yes.
To for her one-liners.
Right, sir. So you can unshare the screen.
Yes, I'm trying to unshare. Sai, can you unshare for me from there?
Done,
sir. Yeah, it's done. Yeah.
My screen is visible?
Yes, Rolika.
Okay, so this session is not called one-liners. This session is called As Easy As It Gets. So my one-liners won't really trouble you at all. The first question is, sunflower cataract occurs in. Now, I'm sure that you all will get this. So I'm already starting the timer. Now, make sure that you don't get confused. So these are easy sessions for you to be encouraged, and I hope you answer them right. So I think this is the time when everybody puts their pen down and they're like, yes, we got this right for sure. It's the Wilson's disease, also the hepatolenticular degeneration. So the interesting part is that who gave the term Wilson's disease? The whole concept of sunflower cataract occurring in Wilson's disease was given by Simon Ling and Olaf. And in 1932 or so, it was thought that it is due to deposition of silver. So yes, this is hepatolenticular degeneration, and it occurs due to the deposition on the lens. And we move on to the next question.
Hold on, madam.
Please let me know.
Yes, Sai, any confusion?
Just too many answers, doctor. I just have to say.
Yeah, Wilson's disease or hepatolenticular degeneration. Can we accept Rolika for that?
Right, sir. You can accept both.
You can have these two only options. That's it.
Yeah. It is basically due to the deposition on brain, putamen to be specific, or liver, cornea, and even in kidney. So till that is done, I can go on talking about Wilson's disease if required.
Done. Please go ahead. Okay. Yeah, it's done.
All right. So moving on to the next question is, the general anesthetic agent which has least effect on IOP in infants is. So be careful while answering. You have only one shot. You cannot mess up the spelling. And even if you do, the concept remains the same. Okay, so while Mr. Sai takes care of the answers, so the answer is ketamine. So most of the general anesthetic agents that we use in infants, or even when we use it for calling as examination under anesthesia, we'll end up using the anesthetic agents which are technically lowering down the IOP. They don't raise the IOP, or which have a hypertensive effect. Whereas ketamine either keeps it stable or has less effect, or causes an increase in the IOP. So the answer was ketamine, which was quite striking. Or even succinylcholine has a reverse effect. So Mr. Sai, let me know if you are done with computing the answers.
We can go ahead.
Okay, perfect. We can go ahead. So the next question is very easy. I'm starting the timer already. Birdshot chororetinopathy is associated with which HLA? And this is absolutely easy. Mr. Sai, it will be a number and along with an alphabet. So make sure that the alphabet and the number are correct. Both should be there. Okay. as I said, it's as easy as it gets. A29. So even if you receive the answer as A29, it's acceptable. Only A is not acceptable. Only 29 is not acceptable. Is that fine, Mr. Sai?
Yes, just give me a moment. Too many answers.
Yeah. So whenever you let me know, then only I'll proceed to the next one.
You can inform him, them, tell something about the subject.
So the birdshot chorioretinopathy, like, so most often you see a 95% association of birdshot chorioretinopathy, which HLA 829. You also see an association with the HLA B27 occurring in it. But yes, that's, there's not much to tell. Again, otherwise I can go on to APMEE, but that's all. The associations are important. They do come in your exams. You have from A to D. Make sure that you know them all. So that's all. So I can go ahead to the next question. Are you ready?
Sai?
Yes, you can go ahead with the next one.
Okay. So the next question is, in BPES syndrome, BPES syndrome, as we try to call it, E stands for what? Your time starts now. So E stands for epicanthus inversus. So Mr. Sai, you have to make sure that the two components are correct. If they say epicanthus only, it is not acceptable. If epicanthus is followed by something besides inversus, it is not acceptable. And for just for your knowledge sake, BPES syndrome is basically blepharophimosis, epicanthus syndrome, and blepharophimosis, ptosis, epicanthus inversus syndrome. And the three components which are important in it would be telecanthus, ptosis, and epicanthus inversus. So as we would like to call it, it's more like an Asian look or like a cute look, but the cosmetic aspect is something that the families are always concerned about, and we can do a cosmetic correction in these children. So let me know if it's okay to proceed, because I think you might get variable answers in this. So moving on to the next question, absolutely easy. So the genetic mutation associated with retinoblastoma is seen on RB1 gene, but on which chromosome? Your time starts now. So I think I've given a tough time to Mr. Sai, because he'll get multiple correct answers in this. And 13 is the chromosome. And to be specific, it becomes 13q14. So retinoblastoma gene is a proto-oncogenic gene, and it's basically a tumor suppressive gene. And it prevents excessive cell growth by inhibiting the cell cycle progression. So this is all from my side on the one-liners. I hope you guys get it right, because this was as easy as it gets. So over to you, Vishal sir.
Hello, Lika. Thank you. I'll just share my screen. So good evening again, and I'll be presenting the last set of MCQs, 5 each for the quiz masters. So listen carefully. Which of the following statements concerning primary congenital glaucoma is true? Primary congenital glaucoma occurs sporadically and is familial in less than 5% of cases. Option B, epiphora is present on first presentation in under 5% of children. Option C, new retinal thinning preferentially occurs superiorly and inferiorly, resulting in the vertical cupping of the optic disc. And option D, ketamine has little effect on the intraocular pressure measurement during examination. Which of the following statements concerning primary congenital glaucoma is true? These are the four options. You have 15 seconds to answer that. Timer is ticking. Read the options carefully and answer the correct one. Primary congenital glaucoma. Time is up. So the answer, the correct answer is epiphora. It presents on first presentation under 5% of children with primary congenital glaucoma. And just a brief about it. basically, PCG, primary congenital glaucoma, is sporadic and they are familial in 10 to 40% of cases with autosomal recessive and variable penetrative. The classical triad is epiphora, photophobia and blepharospasm, but could be absent in rare cases. And photophobia and blepharospasm occur approximately in 7.5% patients at first presentation, while epiphora is in 3.3%. Sai, can we move forward? Are you done with the computing part?
Yeah, yeah. MCQs, no problem. Please go ahead at your pace, doctor.
Okay. MCQs, no problem. So this is a long question. Just listen carefully. I'll be slow. A half-year-old child presents to the eye department with squint, 2.5-year-old child. On examination, a near angle of deviation was 45 prism diopters. Distance angle of deviation was 30 prism diopters. Near was 45 prism diopters. Distant deviation was 30 prism diopters. The refractive error was 2.25 diopters in each eye after cycloplegic refraction. Ocular movements are full. What is the most likely working diagnosis? Option A, early onset esotropia. B, non-refractive accommodative esotropia. C, partially accommodative esotropia. And D is refractive accommodative esotropia. Near deviation is more, distant deviation is less, refractive error is around 2.5-year-old child. What is the diagnosis? Ocular movements are full. Time is up. The answer is non-refractive accommodative esotropia. So early onset esotropia presents before age of 6 months. And the average cycloplegic refractive error in refractive accommodative is plus 4.75. The angle of deviation is typically the same for distance and near. And despite full spectacle correction, if the distance esotropia is still high, the patient has a partially accommodative esotropia. And a subgroup of patients with accommodative esotropia have significantly larger esotropia at near. That is non-refractive or high accommodative convergence, AC by A ratio. They usually present between 2 to 3 years of age. So the correct answer was non-refractive accommodative esotropia. The third MCQ. Listen carefully. In a patient treated for myasthenia gravis with long-term oral steroids, which of the following would be the best regime for steroid cover for a patient undergoing ptosis correction? How would you supplement for steroid cover for a patient undergoing ptosis correction? A, 100 mg IM intramuscular hydrocortisone just before the local anesthetic. B, 100 mg intravenous hydrocortisone just before the procedure. C, double oral dose for 24 hours post-operative. And D, 100 mg intramuscular hydrocortisone just before the local anesthetic. And in addition, double dose, oral dose for 24 hours in the post-operative period. Your timer starts now. Intramuscular hydrocortisone, intravenous hydrocortisone, oral dose, or a combination of oral hydrocortisone and 100 mg intramuscular hydrocortisone. Time is up. The answer is 100 mg intramuscular hydrocortisone just before the local anesthetic and double oral dose for 24 hours in the post-operative period. It's just, basically essential to provide extra glucocorticoid cover for patients on long-term steroid treatment because of the required adrenal insufficiency. So ptosis correction would be classified as minor surgery, and intramuscular hydrocortisone is preferred to intravenous for a more sustained duration. So the option D is correct. A combination of intramuscular hydrocortisone plus double oral dose for 24 hours. Fourth MCQ. Which of the following conditions can cause an electronegative ERG, electroretinogram, full field, bright flash in scotopic conditions? Which of the following conditions can cause an electronegative ERG, full field, bright flash in scotopic conditions? Option A, acute macular neuroretinopathy. B, for Best disease. C, retinitis pigmentosa. D, X-linked retinoschisis. Your timer starts now. Electronegative ERG, full field. Which of the conditions will show electronegative ERG? Time's up. The answer is option D, X-linked retinoschisis. Just a brief about this, these ERG, EOG, electrodynamic tests are essential part of investigations into retinal disorders, inherited mainly. And a full-field ERG negative describes an, on the basis of International Society of Clinical Electrophysiology standard, maximum response in which the B wave is smaller than the A normal or minimally reduced A wave and indicates dysfunction, that is post-photo transduction. And the common causes are X-linked retinoschisis, CSNB, like stationary night blindness, CRAO. Few of the conditions will show electronegative ERG. Moving to the fifth MCQ. In addition to limbal ischemia, which of the following signs has been shown to have a poor prognostic value in chemical eye injury? Option A, more than 2+ cells in interior chamber. Option B, central epithelial defect of more than 80% on the cornea. Option C, raised IOP of more than 28 mmHg or more. And option D, severe conjunctival involvement of more than 80%. Your timer starts now. Chemical injury of the eye, poor prognostic factors. More than 2+ cells, epithelial defect, raised IOP, severe conjunctival involvement of more than 80%. Time's up. The answer is severe conjunctival involvement of more than 80%. Brief about chemical injuries. So before 2001, we were following Roper Hall classification, and now we are following Doha's classification of chemical injuries also. And the reason for modification are that limbal involvement is more objective and consistent than limbal ischemia, which can vary considerably among clinicians. And conjunctival involvement in particular predicts the extent of conjunctival stem cell loss, which actually plays a vital role when there is a significant limbal stem cell deficiency. So thank you so much. I'll be, stop sharing my screen and requesting Dr. Sugata Paul to share his screen for the next set of MCQs.
Thank you, Dr. Vishal. Lovely questions. So I'll go on to my thing. So it will be again an easy round. Yeah. So the second round of MCQ from my very easy question. Low dose atropine eye drop available in Indian market for myopia control is 0.1%, 0.01%, 0.001%, and 1%. So your time starts now. So again, no explanation is required. Very easy question. I'm sure every one of you got it right. It's 0.01%. That is the one which we use for myopia control in India, not 1%. So coming to the next question, again, an easy one, which is the full form of DearSeer.net. Is it diabetic retina clinical research? Is it diabetic retinopathy clinical research? Is it diabetic retinopathy case cohort research? And is it dedicated retina clinical research, clinician research? Your time starts now. Look at the option very carefully. It's a very easy question. Again, I'm sure every one of you got it right. It is the answer B, which is diabetic retinopathy clinical research.net. So coming to my next question, that is question number 3. In C3R, that is corneal collagen cross-linking, which drop do we use? Is it vitamin B1? Is it vitamin B2? Is it vitamin B6? Or is it vitamin B12? The time starts now.
Okay, you may have to pause this question. There's a small technical glitch.
Okay, the time is up. Shall I hold on?
Yeah, what happened, Sai?
I just hold on.
Just okay, let me know when you are ready.
Yeah, you may proceed now, doctor.
Okay. So the answer is again very easy. I'm sure most of you got it right. In C3R, we use vitamin B2 drops on the cornea. So coming to my next question. Crimean fever is now known as, whether is it tuberculosis, brucellosis, toxoplasmosis or toxocariasis. What is the other name of Crimean fever? It was the fever which Nightingale got when she was visiting Crimea, and then later on it came to known as A, B, C, D. Which option you have put? So the answer is brucellosis. Okay, so I'll move on to my last question. Which of the following doesn't handle the oxidative damage in the lens? Option A is vitamin A. Option B is glutathione. Option C is catalase. And option D is vitamin C. So the trick is doesn't. All three does except one. I'm sure, again, most of you got it right because it's a very easy question and the answer is vitamin A. All the other three are involved with the oxidative damage of the lens. So with that, I hand over to Rolika for carrying forward the next set of questions.
Right.
Sai, if you can stop sharing my screen, please.
Okay, perfect. So is my screen visible?
Yes.
Okay. So moving on to the next set, that is the second set. Which of the following HLA haplotypes is most commonly associated with acute anterior uveitis? Focus on all the pointers here. HLA A29, HLA B5, HLA B27, and HLA DW4. So, well, the answer is HLA B27. So, a little about it, 50% of the acute anterior uveitis, like overall, are associated with HLA B27, whereas 90% of acute anterior uveitis associated with spondyloarthropathies are associated with HLA B27. So an association has to be kept in mind with a good systemic evaluation as well. So you must know about it. And with this, I will move on to the next question. The next question is dissociated vertical deviation or DVD. It is a common component of which one of the following conditions? Infantile esotropia, intermittent non-accommodative esotropia, late onset esotropia, or secondary esotropia. So dissociated vertical deviation is a common component of infantile esotropia. So it basically means that there's an upward drift of one eye. In fact, it is affecting both the eyes mostly, while one eye is fixating. And the kids mostly get embryogenic in DVD and in infantile esotropia association. Moving on to the next question. Pseudophakic bullous keratopathy will develop in the endothelial cell count when it is below which one of the following? 1,000, 1,300, 1,500, or 1,700 cells per millimeter square. So the answer is 1,000 cells per millimeter square. So we all know that with age, as the age progresses till adulthood, the endothelial cell count decreases and it kind of becomes stable after 50 years of age. So the normal endothelial count is 2,400 to 3,200. However, corneal deter surgeons occurs when the endothelial count is below 500 to 1,000, and that is when pseudophakic bullous keratopathy can occur in the patients. Moving on to the next question. Which one of the following is the greatest risk factor for prematurity, retinopathy of prematurity? Focus on greatest risk factor here. High level of UV exposure, low gestational age, surfactant usage, or twin birth? So the answer is low gestational age, and I hope this was a very easy question, but often people get confused as well. But low birth weight, that is less than 1500, and low gestational age, that is less than 30 weeks, these are the primary risk factors. We also have suggestive risk factors, that is patients with multiple births, that is twin birth, surfactant usage in patients with the respiratory distress syndrome, even patients with intraventricular hemorrhage, and patients with high level of UV exposure. There is no association as such, but these were the ones to confuse you. Low gestational age is a very obvious answer. I hope you all got it right. So moving on to the last question, a tricky question, but try to answer it. So this is a CT of a 23-year-old girl who presented with unilateral proctosis since 1 year. So what would be the best management option? You would do an incisional biopsy by orbitotomy, an excision biopsy by orbitotomy. You will provide sclerosing agents, or you would observe. So this is a very interesting question and often gone wrong. And that is, as you can see over here, the lesion is very well defined. And a well-defined lesion is something where we can hope for an excision biopsy. Of course, over here, you should always remember an MRI is required. It is quite suggestive because you need to identify the lesion as far as possible. But a well-defined lesion like this, if you can see a slight fossa formation is also occurring in the bony orbital, like over the roof area. So we can always go in by an orbitotomy. It's a superotemporal lesion. We can go a subbrow approach, and we can go ahead and excise the lesion completely. Always try to focus on excision biopsies. A lesion in this area, which could even be originating from a lacrimal gland, never do an incision biopsy. Try to take it out completely. So the best option is excision biopsy by orbitotomy. So these are the questions, and thank you. Thank you, everyone, for the questions. Get over here. So
thank you. Thank you, Rolika. Wonderful quiz. Thank you, Vishal. Thank you, Sugathada. And thank you, Rolika. In fact, you have conducted the quiz wonderfully, and all our participants have done absolutely well. Now it's time for us to invite the top three performers in the comprehensive ophthalmologist category, because every episode we are going to have prize money for them for comprehensive ophthalmologist. As well, today we are also going to invite the top 10 performing teams of today's episode as well. So, Sai, can we have the mark sheets displayed on it, whatever best you can? How much time would it take so that we can interact with them?
In a moment, doctor.
Yeah. So students, so participants, remember, you all have done well. In fact, the scores say that everyone is almost going neck to neck and performing extremely well. And we are happy. Probably the questions were not that tough. Rolika, Vishal, and Sugathada, being a beginner round, this being a first round episode, we have kept the level of the questions slightly easier, I believe. But yes, as we proceed further down the next episodes, the level of the questions are going to increase. But we're really good. We are so proud. In fact, if I remember when I was a student of your age, I would hardly have answered any of these questions, though now they seem to be easier for me. What say Vishal? Vishal is from RP Center. I think he is from a big institute. He might have answered all those questions right.
No, so I think it doesn't matter from RP Center or any other institute. Now everybody is equally smart, and because of all the online resources we have, apart from the books, everything is more smarter than what we were, 10 or 15 years back.
Sugathada, same thing here. See, the students have performed so well. If I look at the scores, whatever are available to me, these people are really a generation next, I believe. Rolika belongs to that generation. Probably she can represent them. So, Sugathada, hamara generation to bahut purana lagne laga hai, inka knowledge.
At the time, we didn't even have internet, leave alone and these courses. So, as Rolika's CV shows, she's one of the budding ophthalmologists, and I think the generation is completely different, the generation, and to help them, people like you, then Dr. Hunava, there are so many courses, online courses are going on, which can be attended easily. So many YouTube resources are there. So yes, this generation, be it clinical, be it surgical, they have all the advantages and they're utilizing it for their best.
So, Rolika, you represent the generation, today's generation. What say? What do you want to say? So, we all feel that you people are privileged, or probably you're more hardworking if I put it the other way around.
I think it is the other way around. It is not a privilege to us. In fact, it is hard work of our seniors, which has become our privilege. So it's we can take it as a privilege, but it is 25 years or 30 years of experience of our mentors, which is being utilized by us. So it's your efforts which we are able to, bear the fruits for. Like, we are kind of being spoon-fed because of what you all have done. So it's your hard work. Like, it's our parents' hard work. It's your hard work which is getting transferred to us. So it's
you're not very diplomatically many. Always right, Rolika. Probably,
no, sir,
but I would definitely give a credit, because see, everything is on a platter, but you have to choose, you have to earn for it, and you have to pick up the right thing and make an effort to rather relish and eat up those knowledge, and then only you can be as intelligent as the today's generation is, probably. We were about, if I look at my own career, I was a bit on a lazier side. So I don't know about Saugatada and Vishal, but for me, even if the resources would have been, probably I would have been a bit lazier.
As academics was the last thing on our mind, and you know, getting surgeries was the top priority. So,
yes,
I think still that is the
case. So for I would also tell all the new gen people that as sir said, that surgery has been a priority for all of them, but we are actually very lucky that our mentors are kind of teaching us through observation as well. So don't ignore that part. For them, they had to operate a lot and then learn. For you, you can observe your mentor. Like for we are privileged to be observing Dr. Santosh when I was, sir. So whatever he does, all the steps that we do, we observe that and we learn. So it's your mentor's experience which is being transferred to you.
Okay. So we have, I request all the participants to not log out yet. We will be inviting the top 10 performers today. So, and top three is Jishnu, RPC1 and Oculus Repair. So please do log in on the Zoom platform. We would like to interact and know about you more. We will be, meanwhile, our backend office, Mr. Sai, is working on who are the rest seven and also the first three performers from the comprehensive ophthalmologies. So this is which team? Your team should, your name should reflect over there.
Good evening, Jishnu.
Welcome.
Yeah, we are Jishnu, sir.
Good evening. Which college you represent?
So we are from L.V. Prasad Eye Institute, Hyderabad. We are first year residents. Wow. I'm Dr. Parth. And
I'm Dr. Anirudh.
You are Anirudh? Full name, yeah?
Anirudh Herur.
Okay. Anaga's son.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Come. Welcome. So, these are the first year residents. Vishal, look at it. Sugatada, look at them. They are first year residents answering so confidently, and they are within the first three.
Amazing. Who's helping them?
Very well done.
Very well played. So, why? What does this Jishnu mean? We can't
actually, Jishnu is the apartment's name where we live.
We registered at the last minute.
We just registered today, sir, so we couldn't find a team name. So, we just thought we'll keep the name of the apartment where we stay.
Keep the name.
Okay, very well played. So, yeah, stick back to the Zoom platform. The other team is RPC1 and Oculus Respiro. Please do log in. We're waiting for you to interact. Our Zoom. Meanwhile, Vishal, you can have some questions for both of them. Or Sugatoda, you can interact with such intellectuals. They are at number one today. But remember,
yes, also
it is going to be the best of four performances. So it has to be cumulative best four performances, which will be considered for being qualified. Okay.
I just have one question for the team, Jishnu. You can give us a feedback of, you know, the problems you face, so we can, you know, improve in the next session while answering the questions. The network was fine, the platform was fine, it was smooth for you guys.
You're mute, yeah.
Yes, sir. It was actually good only. Only thing with the one-liner questions, sir, I think we faced a little problem because we used to answer some, we used to answer and then, you know, the answer was like any apostrophe was missing and then we used to get the answer wrong. So like monitoring that would be a little difficult for like, you know, 500 participants.
Sure.
Right. I've also received 2-3 messages regarding the same, that if it's HLA 829, so the slash is not there, they're not accepting it. So don't worry, we'll look into it. You all did well.
I think... Is it not accepted? The dash in between probably is being accepted as correct answer.
No? We will be taking into consideration. Mm-hmm. Don't worry about it. We have another team which has joined me, Vinith Batwani. Can you just get your video on, please? As well as Oculus team, get your video on. So, which college you are representing, Vinith?
Sir, RPC Ames.
Okay, introduce yourself.
Sir, I am Vinith, final year resident.
I am Soumya, final year resident.
Okay. Okay, good. Welcome to this. So, how did you find the show?
Sir, it was good. The only thing being which the team Jishnu pointed out, we also faced the problem in these one-liners, an apostrophe or a space if it was missing or the answer was having a bit of like change in that, it was not accepting it.
Fine, we accept it.
That was the only problem.
There was one person from your alumnus who was a quiz master. Probably he has not picked out any of the questions, probably.
No, sir.
Okay, don't pin that on me. Okay,
So we have another Oculus team as well. So Oculus team, come on. Come together. We cannot see your faces. Yeah. Please introduce yourself.
Sir, like Sri Lakshmi Naina from Karnataka, sir.
Which place?
Himsa.
There is an echo in your sound. Can you just help us out? Probably there are two devices on, I believe.
Himsasan, sir.
Okay. What is that? I didn't get you.
Can you type that? Because we are, you're not very
audible. Echo whenever
you... Institute of Medical Science.
Okay, good. So from Karnataka, which place you said?
Hasan, sir. Himsasan.
Hasan. Okay. Okay, and who is your mentor? None of the team members told us about your mentors. Have they logged in?
No, sir.
Okay, so congratulate them on BFF for fielding such a great team. Both of you, RPC as well as the LVP team. We have another team that is Chashme Baddur. Where are you from? Please introduce yourself.
Good evening, sir. We are from Sitapur Eye Hospital, Sitapur. We are finally residents, Dr. Nidhi Tomar and Dr. Anupam Singh, and our mentor is Dr. Indranil Saha, sir.
Okay. Anupam, aapko baat nahi karne deti hai kya?
No, sir. It's not like that, sir.
Nahi, bhai, aajkal ophthalmology mein female ka predominance hai. Soon le ya karo.
That's true, sir. In the batch of 15, we have 8 females, sir.
Oh, it's not that badly skewed, but elsewhere it is very skewed. Almost 90% of the postgraduates which are coming into ophthalmology are girls, female students. So it's a good thing. Being a father of two daughters, I feel very proud. We see a great future for ophthalmology and the girls in our country. So how did you find the quiz? Sir Sugotada Vishal, you can interact with this young blood.
It's same, sir. The coffees and dash problems was there in the one-liner.
Okay. So welcome. So we have another team that is Gautam R. Gautam? Can you get your video on? We also have AJ Hawkeye and as well as Bhogi Rahul. Please get your videos on so that we, the spectators, all the audience also come to know who are these young enterprising guys who are those so intelligent guys.
Hello.
Please.
Good morning, sir. There is a small problem with my webcam.
Okay. Where are you from, Gautam?
This is myself, Gautam, and my teammate, Dr. Anuri. We are finally residents from Jipmer Pondicherry.
Okay, welcome. See, last year, Jipmer made it into last three. So we will be looking forward to you performing and repeating the same thing. So who is your mentor this time?
Dr. Nirupama Kasturi.
Okay, tell Kasturi madam has logged in today?
No, sir.
Okay. Do congratulate her on your behalf, on our behalf as a BQ team. So get your video on. Next time you should be ready to be with us. Chashme Baddur team, can you be there with us? Vishal, Sugotoda and Rolika, these are young bloods, big brainy people. I'm short of words. Can you just interact with this guys and congratulate them?
I found the very interesting.
AJ Hawk team. AJ Hawk.
We should have a prize for the best team name also.
Yeah. We will consider. AJ Hawk team, can you introduce,
hello,
please?
Hello, sir. Hello, ma'am. We are from AJ Mangalore. I am Shriya.
I am Akshay Bandari.
Okay. Congratulations. Sugatada, kya bolte hai ye bachcha ka? Karnataka ka dusra team hai.
Rolika, ma'am.
We can't hear you.
The postgraduates are really doing well.
Sugatada, you are muted, Sugatada.
I think whole of South India is doing well. See, Jibmar. Then LB Prasad, then Hasan, then again another from, was it from Mangalore? Sorry.
Yes, sir.
Mangalore. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So you are all doing very well. So what's happening? We shall only one team from M so far. From North India, only one team so far.
Last
one. But we need more participation. Okay.
Just kidding.
So AJ Hawk team, who is your mentor?
Dr. Samprita, ma'am.
Congratulate her on behalf of BQ team. Okay. And we would expect them to log in next time. We would definitely like to interact with the teachers who are churning out such intelligent students who are competing at national level and coming in within first 10. Okay.
So thank you, sir.
Well, So we have another team that is eye stains. Okay, eye stains, where are you from? Can you introduce? And Rolika to interact with these young people.
Good evening, everyone. We're from RRMCH Bangalore. I'm Dr. Shweta.
Okay, South Indian team.
I'm Rahul.
And your mentor?
Dr. Satyalakshmi.
Okay, good. Congratulations. Rolika, kya bolti ho? Bolo bhai, kuch poochho ye
bachcho. South India is completely like on the top, but at the same time, most of the institutes are in South India. So, and RPC is right here. So,
That's Jaipur blood speaking, I believe, defending. okay. No issues. So, congratulations once more. I think we have all the teams.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah, please.
Sir, actually, we also have the team who won third. The team is also from LV Prasad. They are unable to join, actually.
So it's Oculus Repairo. They are
Oculus Repairo.
Okay. They are not able to join?
Tried to contact them, sir. They are not able to join.
Can you help them out in logging in? And Sai, can we have the first three of the comprehensive ophthalmologists who made it?
I've already sent the invite to the third team, and they are yet to join. They'll join right now, I think.
Okay, they have joined it. Okay, meanwhile, do we have the first three episode winner from the comprehensive ophthalmologist, non-PG category? Sai, do you hear me?
Yeah, I'm
the Oculus team is here. You can say hi to them, Dr. Prashant.
Yeah, Oculus team. Where are you?
Sir.
Just introduce yourself. Yes.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah. Sir, can you hear me, sir?
Yes.
Sir, I'm final year postgraduate, sir. Sri Lakshmi.
Okay. You did introduce yourself, no?
Sir, actually, this thing has been sent to Oculus Repairo is the name of the team.
Yeah. So this is Oculus.
I think there are two Oculus teams, if I'm not wrong. Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
Okay. No issues.
Yeah.
Sometimes we need to, Mr. Herur, we need to have some beautiful faces as well. And they are also equally intelligent. They are into first year.
Yes. Seven,
12, don't worry about it.
Ye tumhare senior nahi hai, right?
Okay. So who is this team now? Gautam R is logged in very well. Well, you are a team from JIPMA, correct? Please unmute yourself.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, there is a bit of a echo. Please put off the other device. Otherwise, there will be a lot of echo.
Oh, yes.
Gautam R, team.
Yes, sir. We have put off the other device.
Okay, just introduce yourself once for the sake of viewers. We missed you.
I'm Dr. Gautam R from JIPMER, final year.
I'm Dr. Anuri from JIPMER, final year.
Okay, well played. Congratulations once more. So I think, Sai, what is the status of the comprehensive ophthalmologist winning this episode? 3-2-1.
Doctor, I need some help offline in doing that, doctor. Can we?
Okay, we will announce it next time.
Yes, that's better.
Okay, so friends, we had a great session. First episode of this season 2 of BQ has been quite a great, well attended. More than 534 people logged in. And out of that, 10 best performing teams for the 2 days episode, we have had a small chat with them.
And, sorry to interrupt again.
Uh-huh.
People who are not able to join on Zoom, still played on Kahoot. We have 893 participants on Kahoot.
893, don't tell me.
Yes.
That's a phenomenal record, I believe. So, whom do I pat? Mr. Ashok, sir, or Navneet, or Mr. Sai? Or the team of BigQ? Okay. So, friends, okay, really. So, frankly speaking, 893 is a thing which we never, ever anticipated or expected for us to have such a big participation. That means we would have had 893 into 2. That means almost 1,800 participants plus almost 800 teams. Mentor means it would be almost, look at it. So, this is the type of a viewership which we got for today's episode. I'm really extremely thankful to Rolika, Vishal, and Sugatoda for bringing out such beautiful questions and keeping the students well engaged and stimulating their knowledge well. So, things which we learned from some hiccups which we had during the first episode, just for the sake of viewers, remember, people who could not log in, don't get disheartened. As I said, there are going to be 8 preliminary rounds. That is, 7 more preliminary rounds are to happen. It will be happening on first every Wednesday at 8 p.m. again with new quiz masters naturally next time. And the best 4 performances of all the 8 preliminary rounds will be considered for qualifying into the qualifiers, that is the quarterfinal round. So still don't get disheartened if you had some technical snag or you missed upon or your co-fellows were not aware of it. I'm sure tell them, inform them and ask them to log in next time and they can definitely cover up the marks because it is the best of the 4, the total of the best of the 4 performances which will be considered. Now regarding the comprehensive ophthalmologist, we had a prize money for them for every episode. We would be needing some more time. So when we come out with episode number 2, that is on coming Wednesday at 8 p.m., we will be announcing the winners of the comprehensive ophthalmologist category at that particular time. And we would be felicitating them with the gift money as well. So friends, looking forward to your active participation and spreading a word in and around to everyone, all other co-fellows, co-PGs, and in getting them involved into this activity. We will be thankful for that effort of yours as well. So congratulations all the team who participated and to the best 10 performing teams as well as to the general ophthalmologist first 3 people who stood out, whose name we will be declaring shortly. And we are also thankful to our quiz masters, Sugatoda, Vishal and Rolika, once more for bringing out and making it so lively and engaging this particular quiz episode number 1 of Big Q season 2. And also we are thankful to Ashok and Manna sir as well as Navneet from Microvision for having us together, because without money nothing is possible and they are the people who are sponsoring such a big prize money for everyone, and more importantly they are making effort to get the PGs enrolled from every college from across the country, from any corner of our country as well. As well as we are thankful to Numeratech team, and we are sure what we learned from today's few glitches, we will be having more comfortable and more smooth episode number 2. So thank you once more, everyone. So it's time for us to sign out now. Bye-bye once more. Thank you.
And thank you to you. Thank you so much. You and Dr. Shilpi for all the hard work behind the scene. So thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
It's a very, very great experience, actually, for me, and I'm sure for all of you who have participated today. Thank you so much.
So let's catch up on coming Wednesday. That is going to be the 11th of January at 8 p.m. with episode number 2. Bye-bye till then.
Good night, sir.
Thank you, Vishal. Bye-bye.
Bye.